Good afternoon, and wish you all a very happy and eventful 2016. A very warm welcome to IIIT-Bangalore, for those of you who have come from outside. We are starting a public lecture series. This is the first of the public lecture series. It is going to be reinvigorated from past, according to the director. Unfortunately, the director, Dr. Sarabhopan, is not able to be here today. What we would like to do is first, in our traditional way, we would like to light the lamp to start the public series lecture, starting with Professor HENNING SCHULZRINNE's talk today. So I request Professor SCHULZRINNE, Dean, Academics and R&D, to come over here to light the lamp, and also one student. Faculty member, Professor
Chakrabarty,
please.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you, Professor Sridhar, for your introduction. So, from IIIT Bangalore, we have planned for these public lectures again from starting from 2016. Previously, we used to do it in from 2005 to 2008 as a BAN, means Bangalore in IT. So in that series, public series, we did for 3 years. We called it as a BANG in IT, in short. Bangalore, we made it short, BANG in IT. It was mainly related to the information technology areas. Then from there, 2008, we did our lot of other activities increased, and then we stopped it. Then again in 2016, we started this series. And thanks to Professor HENNING SCHULZRINNE, who is one of the top eminent scientists and engineer in the areas of the networking communication, I agreed to give this talk. And I also thank all of you who have come from the industry and the academia to attend this talk. And we'll keep you informed from our side for this talk in future. And it will be every 2 months or more frequently as we get good speakers. Thank you again, and I request Professor Sridhar to introduce Professor HENNING.
Thank you very much, Mr. Das. This is an opportune time for us to listen to my team from Professor SCHULZRINNE. This year is going to be the year of 4G for India, right? So we just crossed 1 billion. In this one aspect, we can always compare ourselves with China and US. So we are more than US in terms of mobile subscriber base. In fact, the internet subscriber base has crossed at 400 million, more than that of the US. The mobile penetration is close to about 100 million and is expected to surpass the US in about 2017. We have 3G already rolled out in many parts of the country, and 4G is being rolled out. And this is unique. I was talking to Professor SCHULZRINNE. They have about 10 to 11 operators, which is never heard of in any part in the world. We have operators providing mobile services in all bands, 800, 900, 1800, 2100, 2300, 2600. And we have technologies such as CDMA, GSM, WCDMA, TDLTE, FDLTE, all those kinds of things in our network. So it's very, very appropriate time for us to listen to Professor SCHULZRINNE on 5G, what is going to be happening in the future. So it's my pleasure to introduce Professor HENNING SCHULZRINNE, who is the Levy Professor of Computer Science at Columbia University in the US. He received his PhD from the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. He was with AT&T Bell Laboratories and an associate department head of GMD Focus in Berlin before joining the Computer Science and Electrical Engineering department at Columbia University. He served as chair of the Department of Computer Science from 2004 to 2009 as engineering fellow at the U.S. Federal Communication Commission in 2010 and 2011, and as chief technology officer and currently technical advisor to the U.S. Federal Communication Commission from 2012. He has published more than 250 journal and conference papers and more than 70 internet RFCs. That's the most important thing that you know. Protocols co-developed by him, such as RTP, RTSP, and SIP, are now new internet standards, as all of you know. His research interests include internet multimedia systems, ubiquitous computing, and mobile systems. He is a fellow of the SEM and IEEE, has received the New York City Mayor's Award for Excellence in Science and Technology, the Warren Pioneer Award, TCCC Service Award, IEEE Region 1 William Terry Award for Lifetime Distinguished Service to IEEE, the UMass Computer Science Outstanding Alumni Recognition, and he is a member of the Internet Hall of Fame. So we are glad to have Professor Schulzrinne here.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here. It's first time for me to be at the IIIT, any IIIT for that matter. And certainly I'm very pleased to have so many of you interested in next generation mobile networks. What I will be trying to do today in the time that we have is to give you a little bit of perspective, and obviously it would take much longer to talk about all the details of 5G, but as was pointed out, we now have 3G and 4G very well established around the world, both in developing economies as well as in more kind of traditional well-established economies. And there's now a great challenge to complete what you might see as a transition that has occurred as we have moved forward from 2G all the way on through the generations. And what I want to do is something that, at least in part of my discussion, what I want to do, encourage you, is for all the systems that you look at to take a kind of historical and maybe critical perspective as to why we got where we got it, maybe what we can learn from previous experience. If you got taught networking like I did, textbooks tend to be, and papers for that matter, tend to be pretty much of the, here's the way it works and there's no other way it could work. And maybe I'll talk a little bit about kind of the pre-internet protocols that existed before IP came about, but then there's gonna be, well, we got to IP and that was the end of network evolution. I believe it's more interesting to look at what happened kind of as engineered artifacts for engineered by humans. And humans collectively make lots of mistakes. And they make predictions that turn out to be not quite right. And I think the evolution of cellular systems is a good example of human engineering with all its ingenuity, its advances, as well as with some limitations that I'll try to point out. So let me give you a little bit of kind of a notion, and this is, I think, where the notion of generation actually makes some rough sense. Namely, that if we look at the previous generation, and I suspect this is somewhat US-centric, but I don't think the timeline shift, but the durations probably are fairly similar. So we started out with 1G, which generally, for those of you, I think most of you weren't around when that was first introduced, generally analog type of cellular systems, very much voice-only systems. There was no data at all. The 2G systems, largely GSM, although the US, for example, had other standards. And 3G, primarily characterized by data, 4G internet access, and obviously we'll talk a lot about 5G. Each of those cases, according to this consulting company, we have essentially kind of three phases. Namely, the research and development standardization phase. And for a mobile network, standardization is really one of the major delays and necessities that you have. So that adds a number of years. And then you have two phases, and kind of a time where it takes to peak deployment, where the deployment percentage has reached its maximum. And then you have kind of peak to end of life, when it still exists, like 2G does today, but nobody is deploying additional 2G equipment in that particular region. And so what you'll see is that roughly speaking, depending on how you count years, is that you have roughly about 20 years total life cycle for a technology. That's a tremendously long life cycle for a communication technology in the sense that 2G is still very much with us. and has been for quite a number of years, and will continue to be with us even as we get into 4G almost exclusively for new deployments and to some extent 5G. So generations tend to coexist, and we need to plan for very long lifetimes as opposed to the notion that, I mean, like smartphones that are obsolete in a few years. And this is, I don't know if they use the same kind of generation model in India as they do in the US, and I won't go, this is only peripherally relevant here, is that we have, if you like, we can map the human generation. So in the US, typically, we distinguish kind of the baby boomers, which I'm at the edge of, namely ones that were born after the war, basically, into the early 60s, then Generation X until the 1980s, Generation Y, which are also known as millennials, and then the last one after that. And you can kind of map those because they're roughly speaking, also about 20-some years each in that generation. You can see what they grew up with as their primary telecommunication technology. So obviously, people my generation grew up with landlines, and then the latest ones were kind of then grow up, at least in some parts, when they got their first phone that might have well been a 4G phone. And that kind of illustrates how long time periods we're talking about here. And as I said, generations distinctly overlap, meaning we're always going to have to deal with a hybrid environment as opposed to a clean slate type environment in that. And that's going to be increasingly true in landline networks. Look at IPv version 4 and IPv version 6, for example, but very much visible and to much larger degree in cellular networks. And so one thing to look at, and that goes back to my initial remark, is that every generation kind of you have before actually anything exists, and this is very much true for 5G now, is you have lots of people talking about what that G should be. I mean, what should be the next thing that you should all work on if you're engineers, or that banks should finance, or companies should do and that. And so there's a uniquely for mobile, this notion of preparing and anticipating what happens long before it actually does happen. You could call that hype in some cases, but it also helps to collectively set targets for that. So if we look at, 1G, we won't talk about much here. It is really just was mobility, it was landline phone service, and it was special purpose mobility for people who needed it, like doctors who needed to be called, or maybe taxi drivers that needed to be dispatched or whatever. But it was very much a specialty thing that, because they were bulky and expensive, and not voice quality was terrible, and all of that, it was a specialty market. So let's start with large-scale consumer deployment. Really, was 2G, where you had in many countries that was became a standard thing. So the expectation when 1G transitioned to 2G, and that was a major transition for time, at least in the US, it took quite a number of years to turn off a first generation cell network. The promise was, it's digital, it's clearer, it's, you got much better voice quality than you got on 1G. Right? Then the surprise happened. People cared about the voice quality, but what really got people excited was to type on their small Nokia phone, wave numbers. Anybody still remember that, when you had to type three times to get the letter C or something like that? When you acquired kind of fast clicking skills in this, and T9 and all of these type of abbreviated typing type things. So that wasn't really as well known. SMS was not built into the system. The only thing it had was a message service, which was originally meant to announce to you that you're just being charged more because you're roaming. That was kind of a notion that the messaging service was designed for, and that's why it was short, because all you needed was the cell phone carrier to let you know that you're going to get billed more because you left the service territory or whatever your bill was due. And in 3G, something similar happened. So in 3G, and I suspect that's kind of before most of you got really interested in cell phones, and that kind of, I think in the Indian market, that phase largely got passed by because 3G arrived later. Here is the promise was the web was no longer deniable. The phone companies really didn't feel comfortable with that, at least in the US and Europe. That was kind of this other thing that was IT, that wasn't telecommunication. So they said, well, people do like the web. I mean, we don't really understand it, and it's not ours, but I guess we have to give access to it. So they came up with something called WAP, Wireless Access Protocol, which was essentially a low bitrate version of the web. You had to create special pages just for WAP access. It has to go through translation. You couldn't use regular HTML. You had to really do something special. That turned out to be, as I suspect, who had heard of WAP around here? I mean, is there anybody around here? I commend you for your historical knowledge, but mine obviously was not a kind of a great historical success, needless to say. And what happened then actually was the real web. People, maybe hindsight not too surprisingly, decided they didn't want a dumb version of the web. They wanted to look at the same web pages, maybe a mobile version, but the same basic content as a regular web. And again, it was completely unanticipated, was not really planned for at all. Initially, the only thing you could get on these Nokia phones was this simplified version. 4G, same story, different media. So 4G really had two major changes that it brought with it compared to 3G, namely new modulation schemes at the low level, and meaning higher bit efficiency, that you could transmit more bits per second per hertz, all good. Most consumers, obviously, that wasn't what they cared about. But the next thing that they said, now you can do video on video conferencing, particularly video phone calls on your phone. That was the big promise that 4G would bring, because again, at the time, Skype and other services had barely started, and video conferencing, like H323 video conferencing in commercial realm for kind of board meeting type things had become somewhat popular. And so the big promise as an application was IMS, Internet Multimedia Subsystem, that would deliver primarily integrated video conferencing and video calls in general. Well, I don't know about India in detail. We are now just barely in the US, carriers are starting to deploy a simplified version of IMS called VoLTE, Voice over LTE, where, as the name indicates, it's still primarily voice and people use whatever other applications, Skype and WhatsApp and what have you, FaceTime, to do video conferencing. And what really happened, besides those, is that YouTube and WhatsApp and notifications drove really the 4G model, namely the always-on model, the notification model, the apps, all of these things that really were primarily just internet applications running in the cloud that were where the carrier had really almost no role. The carrier was just dumb transport. Again, so surprise number three, in a sense that the application anticipated turned out to be, at least the ones that was designed for, and a large part of the complexity of 4G is actually the application complexity for IMS. That's at least as complicated as the radio access layer. And then now we have 5G, and it's not quite clear what the application is going to be or what it's going to be advertised. But the one you hear most frequently, at least that I have heard most frequently, is the Internet of Things as kind of the next new application in that. And the notion is we need 5G because 4G and 3G in particular, one of the problems they have is they have enough bandwidth for most IoT applications. That's not the problem, but they have a relatively high latency. So in 5G, it can in 3G, it can easily be several hundred milliseconds. In 4G, it's typically at least 100 milliseconds. And this has nothing to do with propagation. It has to do with the radio modulation and the setup and all of that in that. So you get, relatively speaking, high latency unless you use the IMS channel model for voice when you get unreliable but lower latency. So the idea is 5G is going to be offering 1 millisecond channel latency plus whatever speed of light latency in the backbone network you get in that. Now, I don't know yet, otherwise I probably might make, at least could earn some consulting money for that. I don't know what the surprise is going to be. But given previous prediction history of large telecom operators, I would say it's a fair bet to know that 5G will actually surprise us again as to what exactly it will be used for, simply because we collectively, and these are not dumb people making these predictions, these are highly paid, highly trained people that generally know what they're doing, tech engineers and marketing people and all that, and they still get it wrong. So I think the lesson here is we should be humble in terms of for communication networks as to that the application that are actually going to be used are going to be very different from what you anticipate. Now, there is one common theme that I'd like to emphasize. Namely, one is that in all of these cases, all of these were quite successful. I mean, 2G was extremely successful and still is quite useful in many ways, including for IoT, for example. And all the other generations, certainly 3G and 4G, have been technical successes, as was pointed out just a few minutes ago. So it's not like there was a failure of the technology, of the underlying technology, but there has been this application creation envy at telecommunication carriers and equipment vendors, where they always want to be the next application because they don't want to be just bit pipes. Turns out, unfortunately, what people like to pay them for is to be as dumb a bit pipe as they can be so that they can run other applications that are written by other people on top of as dumb a bit pipe as you can get in that. So I think there's a lesson there to be learned as well. So let me just add a few more points to what I already said, is a few more lessons. So in Voltian IMS, I think one of the lessons that I, three of the lessons, I suppose, that you can draw from that, again, as my personal perspective, is it made three mistakes. Namely, the first one was, who's read the 3GPP IMS specifications? Did you get penalized for having done something bad somewhere? So one person I saw, maybe one other I missed, but as I hope you can confirm, this is not for the faint of heart. It's really just SIP and RTP plus a bunch of other stuff around it, but they managed to extend a spec which wasn't too short to begin with into hundreds and hundreds of pages. And I don't think anybody, I've heard this from people who actually work in 3GPP, that at least one reason why these specifications are so complex, he told me about over coffee at a conference somewhere, many of you students and others don't really know in terms of firsthand experience of standards work, but it's largely driven by large companies, and engineers sent by large companies. So at least the implied notion was that Ericsson and Nokia and Siemens at the time and whoever else in the carriers and all of that had no interest in making it simple, because they knew that a large telecommunication company could implement, carrier vendor could implement it, but small ones couldn't, which was just fine. They didn't really want competition by some small software company to offer the same services. The second mistake, I believe, was that if you look at the 4G, 3G and 4G architecture, there's a very tight coupling between the application, IMS in this particular case, and the underlying layers. For example, really the only good way that's described in detail that you can actually implement is that you have a way of getting quality of service for voice and video services by using IMS. fundamental engineering mistake. Instead of doing modular, narrow interfaces, a tightly intertwined interface, so that you had to use IMS in order to get quality of service, even though, and fundamentally, you can have one without the other. When you could have IMS without quality of service and quality of service without IMS. Not really in 3GPP, not really possible. So I think that's another mistake that I think was probably driven more by traditional carrier notions, as well as kind of a notion is we want to make sure that only we as carriers can implement IMS, not some startup as well. The other piece, which may not be quite, is not a standards issue. Until very recently, there were no inter-carrier interfaces explicitly described for voice. So they kind of, carriers managed to exchange voice. But in many cases, the exchange of voice traffic in the United States, at least, and I suspect elsewhere, was you took your multimedia call. If you wanted to call somebody who was outside your network, you could only do voice. You would have to downgrade to G711, which is 64 kilobit telephone, landline telephone quality, same quality you've had for 50 years. Then you would convert it to TDM. You would use a normal telephone switch. And then you would kind of turn it back into IP. That was, and to some extent is, still the interface between carriers. So multimedia calls now meant that you had to have this big asterisk on your multimedia call. You can only talk to people via video who happen to be the same carrier. So you have to know which of the 10 or 11 carriers your friend is on in order to see if you can talk to them. Needless to say, Skype doesn't have that restriction. Guess who won that particular battle, even before IMS got deployed? Right? So again, I think those are three lessons we can learn, indirectly at least, for a type of applications. Now, this is not restricted to to 3GPP, mind the more Ethernet crowd, I think, has own lessons to learn. So in Wi-Fi, the classical model, Wi-Fi itself has, I think, been obviously pretty successful as a technology, has evolved relatively well through like 802.11b and A and N and G and so on, and followed the advances in modulation technology. But one of the fundamental mistakes, and to some extent actually the cellular network made the same and continue to make the same mistakes, is that they assume that trust is kind of a very asymmetric thing. They assume that the carrier is a good guy, and the customers, even though they will never tell you that, you're potential bad guys. Because you won't pay, you'll cheat, you'll do whatever. Right? And so they need to protect the network against bad customers. Now, what happens, as you well know, is in many cases, they're bad networks. Not so much that the carriers are doing bad things, but that it's now become so easy to build both Wi-Fi access points, certainly, and cost nothing, and increasingly to build 2G and 3G networks. So now it becomes possible to build fake networks and then intercept your traffic in networks. Apparently this is fairly popular for Wi-Fi networks in airports because lots of businessmen hang out there and maybe you can get some secrets in there. But it's also become possible and popular for 2G networks. So in the US, there's been two applications, one law enforcement and one commercial, where so-called IMSI catchers, where they build a fake 2G base station because they're close, they're going to be the stronger signal. They'll happily take your association, and now they have all your data. They have your voice call, so you can intercept your voice call. They know who you are because they got your phone number. They can track you in that. And again, this is used for both law enforcement type purposes, has gotten some controversy, as well as for other systems. And this indeed, there's been recently controversy that somebody built that into a drone. So they, kind of a flying base station, and they would then pick up where people were all around the city. This was more a kind of proof of concept model. Okay? So again, I think the lesson here is trust has to be symmetric. You can't trust the access point as well as vice versa of a user. The other lesson I think that we can learn is that, and again, this goes back to my initial example, that in 3GPP, again, there is very much an ill-defined notion. There are lots of interfaces defined, but there are far too many. I mean, if you look at the diagram, I have one that you won't be able to read in a few slides, but there's far too many boxes where it's unclear what exactly are kind of the minimalist interfaces and which ones can you get rid of and still have a working system, which ones can you combine, all of that. IP, I believe, was partially successful compared to its predecessors, the early versions of networking, like the OSI interfaces, primarily because the interface between layers is very easy to understand, very simple. And again, the trust model, we can't assume that network elements behave themselves. It's easy to impersonate them. Sometimes they go rogue. We need to assume that I need to be able to validate every single one of these elements. And the App Store model, again, illustrates that we need to keep the network itself as application neutral as possible, so that we don't try to predict what will be fashionable 20 years from now. And finally, the one which I think will become a big issue for 5G and is already to some extent, we think of wireless networks as that the bigger costs for wireless networks are spectrum and radios, because those are the stuff that you see. I mean, spectrum you don't see, but the radio towers you do see. And it's clearly obvious you need lots of them. I see towers here in sprouting on every apartment building and what have you. And somebody has to pay for those. But the largest costs longer term, particularly as we share more of a tower infrastructure in most countries now, is actually backhaul. The stuff that you don't see, the fiber that's buried in the ground, and for higher speeds, microwave backhaul becomes less and less feasible. So that worked pretty well for 2G and 3G, not so much for 4G and 5G. So you now need to basically find backhaul and use backhaul where you can find it. The biggest change in 5G will probably not be anything really about IoT. That will all be nice for advertising purposes. It really be the ability to use your home fiber network or your business fiber network in the building and directly get internet access at the building, as opposed to going backhaul with dedicated fiber to some mobile switching center and then to some GGSN network and all of that. So again, as the saying goes, a wireless network is 99% wires, and the cost isn't quite that ratio, but it is reasonably close. Not quite close, but it's certainly a significant, particularly ongoing cost is the backhaul, particularly for operators that don't have wired infrastructure that they can reuse. And this is the picture I promised. So this is a subset of the 3G, 4G type of model. Here is the Internet Multimedia Subsystem. Again, I won't go through in great detail. And these are the IP transport, and you have a resources mission control protocol. Again, dozens of interfaces. Each one of these has a little protocol associated with it. All of this basically makes it as a single complicated mess that you will have to implement. My hope, probably not going to be realized, is that we can dramatically simplify when we get to 5G. There will still be complex components, but I don't have to know about those. The other piece that's emerged since 3G and 4G came on the landscape was that we're now developing niche networks that are taking on some of the functionality that maybe cellular networks were assumed to take on. So we essentially now have four niche networks that each have their own strengths. So we have NFC, which is kind of a swipe type of thing. I don't know how popular they are here. RFID, essentially built an RFID reader built into your phone. And its main advantage is short range, which means you don't have to worry about that somebody else's pass gets charged when you board a bus or something like that. Zigbee as a mesh network for IoT, not quite as successful, but starting particularly for residential one. Bluetooth, obviously, initially meant for headsets and keyboards and stuff like that, now becoming very popular for personal area networks as well as, to some extent, for home area networks. And then Wi-Fi, primarily for speed, public access points, and so on. Each one has a different strength. meaning likely that they will persist for quite a while because they just have a unique kind of value proposition. The other thing that has been happening, which I think many people didn't pay as much attention to, particularly in the IoT side, is that we're now seeing networks that are distinguished by, instead of having gigabits and gigabits of capacity like 4G and 5G offered, 4G promised more than offered, but 5G hopefully will finally get there. My basic rule is whatever speed is promised in NG is delivered by N plus 1G. That's kind of a typical rule. But what's been developing now very quickly is networks which are not competing on speed. Indeed, they're ridiculously slow. So I'll take you one in interest of time, but one which is relatively illustrative of this, is the bandwidth of this thing is 160 hertz. No, not gigahertz or anything like that. This is the for one channel in that, and so the data rate is 160 bits per second or 600 bits per second. You couldn't buy a modem that slow for many years in that. But it is extremely low power, low complexity for N systems, and you can build up a countrywide network like it's been happening in some European countries and parts of the US at relatively cheap cost. It's running on unlicensed spectrum, typically 900 megahertz in that. And so you can put a few towers, one tower per medium-sized city, and you can build a nationwide network that covers a nation or a state relative much cheaper than a 4G or 5G network will ever be. And it's useful for many of the IoT applications that are actually likely going to be outside in kind of outside a home or business or enterprise or a factory type of environment. And many of these don't really have a whole lot to say. Your parking meter, and I haven't seen too many of those around here, but or your billboard or your electric meter, they're not terribly chatty. They don't have a whole lot of interesting things to say all day. Having a message sent once a day is perfectly fine. They just need to convey their latest media reading once a day. That's a few bytes. No need to have a 5G gigabit network to talk to your electric meter. So this is just some more description on these details. Certainly just, again, in the interest of time, focus on one. So you have ranges of 30 to 50 kilometers. Your typical cell tower in 4G, 5G is probably maybe a kilometer or two, simply because it's capacity optimized, okay? And so the data rate, like I said, is in, per base stations, you're gonna have a million nodes. You're never gonna have a million nodes per access per base station in 4G or 5G or 3G for that matter. So where will we see new applications for cellular type of systems? Hard to predict, but one model that's emerging in many countries, I think I've seen some indications about and advertisements about here as well from Airtel and others, that you have for fixed wireless primarily to compete with DSL. Now 4G and 5G will certainly be competitive with many DSL speeds, kind of 5 to 20 megabits actual usage. In that, I would say it's probably more likely to be rural than urban in that case, simply because of spectrum availability and as well as usage of DSL and inability to deploy fiber. But that could actually offer quite an attractive proposition to move people out of low-speed DSL. Now, the problem there is not so much speed. You can get your 10 megabit plus bandwidth. The FCC defines broadband now as 10 megabits down and 1 megabit up. The problem you have is capacity per month. That's where you're probably going to run into trouble if that continues to grow. So the largest cable company in the US, that's where I have data from, published data. Others are probably pretty similar, so residential one. They have a median usage, and this is my take two numbers and draw a line through those and extrapolate. This is why I'm not a real analyst. You have an increase from 16 gigabytes to 40 gigabytes in a matter of about 2 years. So this roughly translates into your nice 50% year-over-year growth. So if 2020 is your notion when 5G is going to be starting to be deployed, that's the goal, you're going to be talking about 300 gigabytes per month per user in that. That's per household, but I suspect it will be many cases per user at that point, just for video primarily in that. And that's a lot of data. I don't know, what's your typical data plan around here that you buy? I mean, how much is that you get when you buy prepay on, is a gigabyte type of thing is your typical thing? And if you're trying to multiply that by 300, I think that's infeasible economically. So really, and this is US numbers, is in the US roughly, and I think actually you're getting much better deals in India than that, it's about $10 per gigabyte for 4G. That seems to be the standard rate. Sometimes a little lower if you buy lots of them, but your standard rate is somewhere around that. So if you wanted to do that, in case you couldn't do the math easily in your head yourself, you would be paying $3,000 a month just for video watching over that. And YouTube and Netflix probably aren't worth that for most people. So you have the wireline costs in US, again, US is pretty expensive for broadband, $55 for wireline, not very competitive. So we have to be careful that it's really more than just speed, it is really about capacity in that. The other application, which everybody else mentions, is embedded applications, Internet of Things type of things. Is there, I would be very skeptical that that's going to be a mass market. Everybody says that we're going to have billions of devices and then imply that all of these devices are going to be on cellular network. I don't think so. Almost all of those devices are going to be in home networks and office networks connected to your Wi-Fi and Zigbee and Bluetooth type of environment for any number of financial and practical reasons. Only very few devices that are outside, away from settlement type of one, traffic lights, that type of thing, they are likely going to be on cellular networks. And most of these are not mobile to begin with. But they're very cost sensitive. So charging $5 to monitor some vending machine somewhere out in the middle of nowhere is not exactly feasible in the US and obviously even less so in India. So again, what we need to look at is the capacity, not the speed. This is now all about capacity, not the speed. I did some additional kind of notion is what happens if everybody switches from watching TV on satellite or something like that to watching it on an IP-based stream, you get roughly the same numbers as I did within the margins of prediction error. This is using US numbers for watching TV in the US as about 146 hours of watching TV per month. Not me, but somebody must be doing that. It's 5 hours a day, roughly speaking. That gets you 410 gigabytes at modest, at kind of standard resolution, not 4K or anything fancy. I talked about the pricing just to illustrate what current US pricing is. They sell them like ice cream cones, except you would not quite pay $100 for ice cream cones. Let's talk about IoT just a little bit. Again, if you look at requirements for IoT, there's really kind of very different notions in that. So you have applications like connected cars, remote health monitoring, and fleet management, which happen to have a large range. You don't want to lose somebody's health monitoring along the way. You have, they're mobile. Then the outdoor ones like smart metering and parking meters and all of that, smart electric meter and gas meters and all of that, they're not mobile. And they're typically a very low weight. Then you have indoor applications like tracking, x-ray machine, mobile EKG machines in hospitals and warehouse forklifts and so on. Industrial automation home, they need a smaller range. And then finally, local personal area network. Really the only ones that are likely going to be cellular are the first two, simply because they need long range and outside the home. This is a US version, broadband pricing. I won't go into great detail here. So one of the other things that I won't try to explain the whole slide here, but one thing that has also been of great interest, in all countries, there is no more spectrum below 3 or 6 gigahertz. essentially, depending on how you count it, in that. So there's been a lot of interest in moving to higher frequency ranges, 6 gigahertz even as a starting point, but also 28 and six, even up to 60 gigahertz. The practical problem that you have is, and this is for, if you're an electrical engineer, but even if you're not, the practical problem that you have is that the attenuation that you get at ever higher frequencies is much higher. So indoor, outdoor to indoor coverage, the typical cellular model, tower outside, a user often inside, is just much, much harder. All right, so you have many more decibels of attenuation for those high frequencies. So that doesn't hurt you if you're using Wi-Fi because it's generally within the building. But penetrating those walls, and this is a big problem around here where most of it is concrete and steel, is going to make that model very difficult for higher frequencies. So you have more propagation, I won't go into that. Gets even worse for 28 gigahertz and all of these. Let's try. Okay, I talked a little bit about spectrum. How much more time do I have?
About
15
minutes.
15 minutes, okay. So as I alluded to, the spectrum environment is two things. A, there just isn't any more available, so you have to move to higher frequencies, but for reasons I mentioned, those are not terribly attractive except for somewhat special purposes. So what's been happening all over the world now is the model that we used to have, namely each application and each kind of industry division, or military versus non-military, government versus non-government, they used to have nicely separated, kind of each had their own play area, so to say. And now they suddenly have to play together because there just isn't enough sandbox space anymore available. So in the US, for example, for the first time, a band which used to be radars, and still is, military radars, is in 3.5 gigahertz, is now going to be shared in kind of three levels of sharing in that. So there's databases that you can look up as to who has what rights. The military gets to keep its radars. That's largely, obviously, it's the Navy, so it's coastal and the Great Lakes in the US. And that needs to be shared in time and space. There just isn't anything available. And it's a really attractive spectrum, nice propagation, 100 megahertz type of spectrum available and that. So what you'll increasingly see is a notion that instead of having cell phones that are just kind of on one channel, like you mentioned, where you have one band, you now have to be support lots and lots of bands, and you may not have all bands available. You may have to switch fairly rapidly between bands, split your, do multi-band type of things. So the radio environment will become a lot more complicated. So you can't just assume anymore that it's like even Wi-Fi, you're one channel, you transmit, receive on it, you're going to be spreading yourself across all kinds of channels, constantly finding out new channels that you can use. All of that needs to be managed. And it needs to happen obviously very quickly so that the user doesn't notice. Right. So I said 150 total megahertz, 100 about usable for that. So that has three models, three levels, namely incumbent, basically authorized federal users, then there's a licensed model, and then there's a general accessibility model. So the other thing that is likely to change is much more fundamental than just technology. It might well change how we think of cellular companies. And here now, we have essentially cellular companies, and I should have put up kind of these red Airtel buildings that you see. I don't know, I mean, somebody must have, Airtel must have spent good fraction of its marketing budget on red paint, given what I see along all highways around here, and Vodafone, I suppose, as well. But this is, again, US-centric. A cell company, basically a national carrier, really has a whole bunch of stuff. They have a network operation center. They have SIM cards. They used to brand, at least, if not, partially design handsets, kind of modify handsets. Okay, they do applications. They have stores. They have, as a minor little thing, they also run a network. They may have towers, and they have backhaul. One company basically doing all of these very different things. It is quite possible that will actually separate out these components and have essentially a roaming model between carriers as opposed to just a simple single carrier. So what might happen, and again, the labels for companies will change, that you can essentially explode a cell carrier into components. So you have, nowadays, many of, at least in the US, and I believe that's true in India as well, is many of the towers are shared and run by separate companies. They sort of lease space on those. So in the US, this is American Tower and Crown Castle, so they have about 40,000 towers each. Right? And then you have backhaul being provided by backhaul IP companies. You have spectrum databases operated by Microsoft and Google and specialized company Spectrum Bridge and so on. You have fiber backhaul running there. You have a network operations that's run by somebody. In many developing countries, it's actually Ericsson that runs that these days. The companies in Africa in particular often don't do anything except be really marketing and sales and end user interaction. You might have companies like cable companies that offer Wi-Fi and maybe LTE-U hotspots to the carriers. LTE-U is the LTE meaning 4G unlicensed version running on 2.4 and 5.8 gigahertz. You have equipment vendors, largely now separate like consumer equipment. Again, like I said, somebody like Ericsson or some service provider would manage the network on a minute-by-minute basis, and you obviously have apps and so on, which are completely separate. So where do you find the cell company in there? There really almost isn't, except for lots of red paint to splash on billboards. So now you can actually imagine that when 20 years from now, you'll have essentially the phone companies or cell carriers are in some sense much more like the airlines. I mean, airlines just lease in many cases planes, they get food from third parties, and they hire flight attendants and pilots, and they brand themselves and advertise, but the hardware is largely owned in many cases by somebody else, banks and leasing agents, and certainly designed by Airbus and Boeing and so on. So you could imagine a very different cell phone model than what we have today. So carriers essentially become a consumer brand which exists on the outside, but on the inside, they're really just reselling and relabeling other people's services. This is for the cell towers, as to. And that is partially, and again, maybe Indian carriers are different, it's partially because they really aren't that great at many of these things that they have in the past had to do. Many of the US-based cell carriers have abandoned all pretense of doing research. They don't really do all that great on software development in that, that's not been their strength. Applications, IMS is a good application that didn't work out so well, and API-based service, they tried, but they really didn't succeed terribly well. You would think that the phone companies would offer APIs for their voice services, for example, and all the other services. Ones in the US that did it first were Twilio and Troppo, startup companies. They offer voice APIs and SMS APIs and so on. And there are many here as well. I've seen a few advertisements around as well. So we should ask ourselves, what is the simplest kind of network that, and this is really a challenge for all of you, particularly ones that are still starting out, is not how can we make networks more complex, but how can we make them simpler in that? So the questions I think we can ask, and this is the challenge for 5G, is what do we really need to build, particularly in kind of a simplified world where you're no longer doing towers and all of that? What do you actually need to build a wireless network? It's not that much, really. You need a so-called AAA server, which basically is authentication, authorization, and accounting. When only paying customers use your network, you need some kind of SIP, voice over IP type of infrastructure, but that can be completely separate. You need just some kind of IPv6 access network, and it really doesn't matter whether it's Wi-Fi or OFDM cellular. You need some address assignment. You need some management of network resources. And in that model, the notion that you have SIM cards and devices that are tied to a provider makes no sense. We don't do that for Wi-Fi. You don't have a Wi-Fi provider typically. There are a few, Boingo and others in the US, but they've really been relatively unsuccessful. So the idea is one subscriber can have any number of devices and any number of providers simultaneously. Why be restricted to one? Why shouldn't the device automatically choose the best one and actually use several at once if you have lots of money and want speed? Why not use multiple providers all at once? Should all work. Do we really need mobility? In many cases, mobility adds lots of complexity. Proxy MIP and mobile IP have lots of security issues. It's hard to do that right. But for many of the applications, like for HTTP video, you really don't care as much about mobility because you're downloading chunks of video. Okay? And maybe you don't even need it for real-time video. So I believe 5G is an opportunity to ask again, complexity adds cost. The mobile field is very much a cost-sensitive business. It was alluded to earlier, nobody seems to be making much money in a competitive environment. So we need to reduce the operations cost, which means the complexity. Okay, we need to simplify enrollment. We also need to get out of our fascination with quality of service. I've been in this business long enough to know that every new network, you can count on it, and it doesn't matter whether it's wireless sensor networks or cellular networks or 4G or 3G, the technical sales pitch was quality of service. Tens of thousands of papers published on that topic. The success of that business model has been modest. This is an example from a US toll highway, which has had similar quality of service and business model problems. Now, you can't read this, but if you have to pay $1.20 for just riding a short distance, not a great surprise. Network APIs need to be provided. Let me just skip through some of those so I can get to questions. One point I wanted to make, because it's often, this is more kind of a business side one. One of the surprising constants of the business models for mobile and landline operators is we all think they need lots and lots of capital. But if you look at how much they actually spend on capital expenditures as part of their revenue, which is kind of one indication of their long-term capital intensity, it doesn't matter whether you take a large US cable company, a very large kind of hybrid European company, or a Kenyan company. Those are data that I could easily get and understand, at least to some extent. Very different companies, different countries, different continents, they all end up roughly around 15%. Only 15% of the cost of what you pay actually pays for towers and fibers and switches and routers and all of that. Right? Vast majority of money is paid on operations and, I suppose, on red paint. Right? So the problem that we have is we need to, if we want to do that, I would say a good carrier should spend lots more money on hardware and software that gets you real services and less on operating with stuff. The other problem, which is also an economic problem, is, and this is all about the network neutrality issues, which I won't go into hearing at least for now, is that fundamentally we value bits very differently. And this is again US prices. In the US until fairly recently when it became free, SMS was about 10 cents, which didn't seem all that much, except if you take that on a cost per megabyte, that translates roughly, if you wanted to run IP over SMS, which you could, that's $625 per megabyte. Same channel, except if you use cable video, this costs you 6 cents, US cent, and as voice costs you a dollar. Okay? So even within mobile, three orders of magnitude. We actually already have a 5G prototype called EduRoam, which allows you to connect to Wi-Fi networks in universities. I don't know if anybody deploys EduRoam in India. So it's in US and Europe for now, where if you have an educational account anywhere in US and in Europe, and I think it's Korea as well, you can get access to the university network just by typing in your email address at your university and your home password, and it gets verified at your home institution. So what do we learn in kindergarten-style lessons? First of all, complexity kills. 5G, I believe, but one opportunity we have is to greatly simplify it, strip out all the legacy of circuit switched voice type of thing, play fair, make services available to others. CapEx, you spend once. Spend on switches and routers and fiber. OpEx is with you forever. That's the 85%. Optimize for that. As network engineers, we optimize on CapEx. I think that's long-term a really bad idea. We need location services. I skipped over that. We need to share all the components that we have. Anticipate sharing, because you might actually get money from sharing. And don't trust the network. Don't trust strangers, because they may not be trustworthy. With that, I'll conclude, and I'll be happily entertain discussion and questions. Thank you so much.
Floor is open to questions.
Or comments, where you've, and I probably get lots of Indian stuff wrong, so. Yes, please.
You mentioned that the network will become simpler, complexity will go down, so the...
That's my hope, yes.
Which is logical. And the carriers, therefore, become less complex organizations.
Yep.
At the same time, there's also the growth of MVNOs. At some level, Google, Microsoft, Apple, and all.
Yep.
So what does that mean to the carriers?
Yes, so just to repeat, since others may not have heard it across the room, is if we assume for a moment that networks get simpler and we have lots of MVNOs, like even traditional services like Google and Apple and so on might enter that, if I got you correctly, what does that leave for carriers? Is that roughly right?
Yeah, and so, again, this is
probably going to be somewhat country specific, namely in some cases you will still have essentially kind of just like you see in airlines, namely you have kind of full stack airlines, if you like, namely ones that actually own the planes, that do a fair amount of engineering themselves, and they have their own food supply, have Lufthansa's of the world, all of us, really large ones. And then you have ones that basically own nothing but the uniforms that the rented flight attendants wear, and they basically consume our organization. And I think that's good, because we'll see essentially, and what you'll also see is we shouldn't focus too much just on consumer. Increasingly, some of those organizations, but not all of them, What you already see in other networking organizations, that they really now is a bifurcation into business type of supporting organizations and consumer organizations. And it's true for trucks, and it's true going to be true. It's true for wired networks. Business often more complex. They want integration services. They don't just want fiber. They want managed networks. They want security services. All of that. So what I could imagine that something similar happens in the mobile world. So somebody, and this is already starting to happen for some of AT&T and Verizon in the US, that they are starting to offer vertical services like plant monitoring and home security services and all of that on top of our services. And their prime advantage is really market positioning, because they already have a consumer-facing brand and they have consumer-facing infrastructure like stores and technicians and so on. And so they might actually do more services than just networks. But I do believe it will actually be essentially bare bones kind of budget airline type versions that provide very commoditized, simple services that primarily compete on price, nothing special, not suitable for fleet management, but suitable for us, so to say, in doing that. That might be one model in that, and we're starting to, and I'm suspecting that that will be necessity to support that will essentially support the simplification of interfaces, because it can slice and dice it in different ways. And like what has happened essentially in the airline model, where they've taken out little chunks of that and were able to divide it out into different organizations and different business models.
My question is, sir, that Mark Zuckerberg is flooring the balloons and
yes.
providing internet in a different manner than the traditional switches and routers. So what will happen to all this, what we have?
Yeah, so I mean, this is more for the hardware. Is that what you ask about? Yeah. And so.
And also the businesses, because all that will take out all the carriers out of the business if that succeeds in a big way, right?
Well, not necessarily. I mean, if you look at Zuckerberg's model, it's by a standard, and obviously I'm speaking to people who should know that, I mean, who probably know that much better than I do, since it seems to be kind of, I mean, four-page network newspaper articles around here, is that Facebook is at the moment, leaving aside drones and all other kind of fanciful stuff, is paying Airtel, I believe, essentially a fee to offer this free basics type of service.
No, I'm not talking about free basics. I'm talking about the free internet that is being flown on the balloons.
Balloons, yeah. I mean, they are, to be quite honest, I see that as this is the last 5% coverage, primarily with extremely high cost. I just don't see enough room for balloons over my major cities. You just do the math and capacity. A balloon is nothing but a really tall cell tower. And the reason that you don't build these TV towers anymore, remember, we used to have these, every major city used to have like a really tall TV tower, where some with restaurants, some not. And the main reason, it wasn't like primarily for tourists, it was primarily so that you could have one Empire State Building, say, cover, that wasn't the main ruling for that, but you had the coverage of a whole metro area for TV and radio and so on, and to some extent other mobile pre-cellular services. But that only made sense in an environment where you had what in the US that's called, or in high power, high tower. Spectrum capacity just doesn't allow that. You need to do much more reuse, which means many more balloons. And at that point, the operations cost, particularly with big cities, I just don't see floating in hundreds of balloons. I don't know how many cell towers there are in Bangalore. They're typically a major city, even forget microcells, has several from each carrier. Each one would need now several hundred balloons. Just not multiply that by 10. You would have a very spectacular sky in that, particularly if they started to be decorated like some of the buses around here. So you get I don't think that's big. Again, it's very useful for rural India, for example, and rural Australia and rural United States, because there you want coverage matters, since the population density is so low, so the higher you can go, the better off you are. And there they'll really be competing with LEO type satellites. That's really the competition there, not cell towers.
Henning, I'm curious why you would say that cube quality of service is no big deal, because I'm sure the dozen Indian operators would be delighted to quote you whenever they are faced with these numerous complaints. In fact, we have been living with substandard services which never measure up to what we pay for. We have 4G launches in the last 3 months from operator after operator. Nobody has ever got more than 2 or 3 Mbps from any of these guys.
Right.
And there is no way for the customer even to go back and insist that he gets what he pays for. So if you say that for 5G, we should not be bothering about quality of service, I wonder in what way 5G will be any different from 2G and 3G which we have been having here.
Thank you. So I do believe, and so this is, I think, one of the kind of, and you illustrated, and I really appreciate your comments on that, because I think it made a really important point, if indirectly, that quality of service is really means two very different things. Namely, one is the one that depending on whether you wear your network engineer hat or your consumer hat. You were just wearing the consumer hat, namely, I want quality of service. I expect quality of service. I pay for quality of service. But what that really means is capacity. What network engineers, when people publish papers and all of that, they worry about differentiating quality of service, which means some small number, because usually it just means that in order to do, if you don't have enough capacity, then all you get is the VIP lane, which you pay for, just like at an Indian temple I visit, when you paid 100 rupees, you get the fast lane. But that only worked because only tourists were in that lane. And so, yes, we need quality of service and we need models, but that primarily means capacity, because just reallocating and prioritizing doesn't create capacity. So what I argue is, instead of saying we need maybe, and you formulated it in some sense better than I did, is 4G and 5G needs to get to the point where quality of service is expected, as opposed to something that you just kind of, if you're really special, you get, because consumers won't put up with it. And it does mean that the regulator, and well as consumer organizations, need to do a much better job. And assuming in a competitive environment, you would imagine that then people will choose based on quality. And that's happening, at least, again, I can only speak to the US, where Verizon in particular makes its marketing pitch is, yes, we are expensive. Well, they don't say that, but that's kind of implied is, but you get, I mean, we have coverage and we are the fastest. And they cite little studies that they've paid for that show that. And there are now efforts, a number of companies offer relatively objective metrics that you can see as to who is the fastest and most consistent and least call drops and all of that. And I suspect that in competitive markets, we need to see a lot more of that happening, so that you can choose whether you want quality of service on average, not by priority. It's really just a business model. Namely, one is, well, yes, I offer 4G, but I don't tell you that that same 10 megahertz channel is shared with 50,000 other people because I want to sell it cheap. And so, yes, quality of service in the consumer sense, not so much worried about prioritization and resource reservation, all that, because it doesn't do what you want and what we all need. So,
Can I ask one question, if I may?
Yes.
Sir, you mentioned on one hand about the carriers should not be trusting Wi-Fi APs. On the other hand, you also put a question mark on HLR.
Right.
So the SIM-based authentication, which has been proposed and released for 3GPP, is not going to take off?
Yeah, so, I mean, a number of parties have proposed to get rid of SIMs. Primarily, not so much because of a trust issue as much. I mean, that's really more, the SIM is really classical user to network authentication. What I see much more happening is that we'll have a version of what we already see for the internet world, where we have certificates, X509 certificates, for both sides. I mean, we currently tend to have it more on the server side. We actually do the opposite in the internet world. The client authenticates in some other way. But longer term, one thing that I'm starting to imagine, at least, is becoming more plausible because of mobile devices and all of that, that you'll actually see mutual authentication with software-based certificates, so that I can easily have multiple. I can switch them out. Again, IoT, one of the big concerns that people have is, what happens if I installed all these devices out in the middle of nowhere and the cell company that operated those is no more? Do I have to drive to all of these places in the Himalayas and switch out SIM cards? So Apple already wants soft SIMs because from form factor reason, it means you can seal your, there's no reason now, since they don't allow you to change your battery anyway, there's no reason to have a slot in your phone anymore. So there's all kinds of practical reasons why I believe that 5G won't have SIMs. But it's a different issue of validating the network. And that's primarily right now a 2G problem, where there was no validation of a network. Basically, you just talk to it, and if it advertises itself as 2G, you have no way of telling, is it real or is it fake? 4G and 3G solved that problem. That's, as I said, primarily a 2G and Wi-Fi problem. There was, I don't know, one more, there were several more questions there, so if somebody manages that.
Just lovely, thanks for the wonderful session here. I have two questions. One is on the technical side of things. One of the major complaints which we hear, no matter what the phone is that the modem consumes way too much power on 4G. And 3G also faces that similar problem over a period of time. Say, for example, you're streaming video for 15-20 minutes, and it doesn't work. It gives discomfort to the user.
you can't hold the phone, it gets too hot, and all those problems. I want to see, I want to hear from you, what steps have been the, have you guys been taking, and what was your proposal for reduction of power consumption, whereas increasing the data rate, so which is a kind of a trade-off, which has to be done. So that's the first question.
Okay, why don't I get to that first, I can make sure I don't forget anything what you asked. And so I'm not a hardware engineer, so don't mind. The only thing that I can say is we all know, and it's relatively well known, at least until we get a really a breakthrough in battery technology, that the battery capacity on a per volume or per gram type of basis has really been only increasing very incrementally, a few percent a year at best. And my sense is that the efficiency of processors also is no great, I mean, there's lots of power management, but that's primarily when you're not doing anything. That's where all the advances have been. The cost per computational bit really hasn't decreased, or maybe joule per bit or per cycle or whatever metric you want to use hasn't decreased nearly as much. And particularly because, again, in many cases, processes for video decoding, and that you have this inherent conflict as you get to H.265, for example, higher complexity codecs. Because you want to reduce the transmission bandwidth, you get higher complexity decoding, which means you, whatever gains you make is probably get immediately eaten up by inherent algorithmic complexity. So I do see now that, so I'm somewhat pessimistic that there is an obvious answer, except possibly what you'll see is the one variable that you do have is the transmission side on that, which doesn't really, it matters more for video conferencing than for YouTube type thing. So as you get smaller cell spacing, the power that you need, the RF power, goes down significantly. So that saves you, and this is, as we all know, is as you get higher density, your battery lasts longer. And so that's, unfortunately, I'm not aware of anybody having proposed, even kind of as a hypothetical thing, a major breakthrough that will actually change that. In terms of either battery, until we get some kind of hydrogen battery or who knows what. People have talked about doing that, kind of replaceable hydrogen fuel cell type of battery, which will make plane travel exciting. And the other one is, as I said, cell spacing. My general sense, however, is, and this is, again, maybe as much a cultural thing as anything else, is that the notion that you do a handheld device watching video, I have to admit, I worry about my safety just walking without my cell phone when I'm walking on the street. I think it would be suicidal to watch a video while I'm at it. So it's really two cultures where you see that as an issue. Namely, one is public transportation-rich cultures like Japan and Korea and on the Asia side, and Europe to some extent. And there, my sense is you'll see a lot of Wi-Fi and other very close by transmitters, and my sense is, again, not being a hardware engineer, that solves at least a fraction of the problem. And the other one is those of you who are lucky enough to not have to drive to work yourself, but have somebody else drive and you sit in the back seat. But you're supposed to be doing email for the company anyway during that time, so I'll solve that problem that way. So I have a non-answer to that, but second part of the question.
It was interesting that you compared the model of the business model to an airline for 5G networks. It's been interesting that this is the model which airline industry of course followed, and there has been a significant downwards on their revenue because of the increase in operating costs. And we see almost every airline in loss. Now,
not in the US, yeah. Sure.
Yeah, there are who make profits, but there are quite a few airlines which do make loss, and that's the significant part of the airline industry. Now, if that is the case, then when you try to socialize this kind of a model with the telecom industry, How do the telecom operators react?
Yeah, so, I mean, none of them are, I mean, I don't think any of them are terribly pleased with any of it. I mean, because, and I do believe the airline industry and the, the carrier industry increasingly share one thing in common, in a sense that they're largely, that the intellectual kind of contribution that they're making to the service is, relatively speaking, diminishing. In a sense that I'm not an airline guy, but my sense is initial part, it was relatively speaking a difficult thing, partially also because of communication difficulties. To set up a niche, particularly international carriers, to have an international footprint in all these airports, coordinating all of that, in the era of fairly difficult communication, that required expertise that was very hard to replicate. And same for cell phone service, obviously. And that's why we all had research labs at one point. Now they don't. I mean, it's largely repackaging stuff that they buy more or less ready to go from vendors. And increasingly, particularly as we talk about hardware type thing, is that as that gets commoditized, it's really just a data center. And in my ideal world, you and I should be able to, the only qualification for setting up a wireless a cellular network is the lack of fear of heights, so you can climb up a tower. Everything else, again, if you think of installing a Wi-Fi network, and how much training do you need? You need to be able to plug in that yellow cable, find the screws in the back, and plug it, find the other end and plug it into one port and the Ethernet switch. You're done. And why should a cellular network be more complex than that? And so I do believe that whether the cell companies like it or not, that's really not the issue. In both the air transportation industry and in the bus industry and other similar type of things, and taxis, you name them, type of industries, which are all very similar in many ways, are consumer facing commodities where people expect a certain quality of service. It becomes increasingly possible to compare the quality of service, which wasn't really as feasible before. I mean, see Ola and all of that. And on the taxi side. And where there's essentially, then you get two models, namely one where there is true competition, you mentioned for airlines. What companies actually do is they do two things, and I'm exaggerating, but for effect here, but in public, they say, oh, this is all really, really complex, and only we can do that. In private, they try to get down to fewer than three or four operators, and this is true airlines in the U.S., and this is why U.S. airlines are making so much money, besides the fuel cost issue that they got just a really good deal on fuel now. Is that you have if you're down to particularly two dominant carriers like in the US, you essentially don't have to worry about these issues because you have market power. So in many cases, the outcome really will be one, will you get in a situation where there's market power? And then none of this matters. This is all then becomes local optimizations as to what companies decide to do in-house versus not and all of that. Or is it a fully competitive environment, in which case, yes, this is inherently a brutal business, because if you study economics, it tells you that in a competitive market, you make zero profit. But that's the definition of a competitive market, is essentially you survive, but you don't get rich. And By nature, it's a commodity. This is not if you're just providing a service, this is a commodity. It has to become a commodity, otherwise we can't afford it. Anything which is affordable to 900 million people has to be a commodity. So.
In literature nowadays, there's increasing work on how there is collaboration between IT and Wi-Fi and other such technologies, 4G and above. So how does that add up to your complexity picture?
So, I didn't quite get the first part, so...
No, there is increasing work on, say, LTE,
yes,
back on Wi-Fi spectrum and so on. So how does that add up to your?
Yeah, so I mean, part of it is, if you look at how Wi-Fi handover to LTE in particular is done, it's still fairly complex at the moment, because you have to essentially integrate a non-cellular network. You have to integrate into HLRs. You have different IP addresses. You have to run tunnels, because otherwise it can't work through the same. It has to go through the same internet gateway. That all adds complexity. My notion is, if you treat every base station, and it really doesn't matter at that point whether it's LTEU or unlicensed or whether it's traditional cellular, you just get an IP address just like you get from a Wi-Fi access point. A lot of that backhaul, background complexity that we have today to make it work reliably will go away. So I do believe that, yes, that is happening to some extent, but if you look at these transfer mechanisms, they're pretty complex, particularly if you need to secure them. Because you now need to make sure that somebody doesn't suddenly say, I'm on that Wi-Fi access point, but you really aren't. And that much mobile IP is not, the complicated part is not the mobile part, it's the security part. 90% of a specification that nobody understands is the key negotiation between the two parties in that. I always fail when I try to explain that in class. The mobile part is easy, sending a new IP address, man, we can all do that. It's the security part that makes it hard, and that's because we assume that the constancy of identifiers.
One question for Keith. Last one?
Yeah.
I guess one of the things that intrigued me is surprising applications that came up of the original, intent of the design.
Yeah.
So do you have any indications from the pilots what kind of applications are in pipeline for the 5G networks?
Yeah, so no, I don't. So I can only guess. And there have been two kind of what I would say predictive algorithms that I think work reasonably well. Namely, one is high bandwidth applications that are currently on wired networks invariably migrate to wireless networks for reasons. I mean, in some of you, this is kind of a variation of what you said, is we expect two things. Namely, one is decent quality, and that means we're used to it on wired networks to some extent, and we expect to do the same thing that we do on wired networks on wireless networks. So you can take whatever virtual reality, games, immersive type stuff on that. The second one, and that's kind of sort of the opposite end on that, is ubiquity. We now expect, and we're starting to see applications, and this is where I mentioned Sigfox and LoRa and those type of things. Their play is not, as I said, on bandwidth. It's essentially on ubiquity, because there are many applications that really are only economically feasible if you don't have to worry about whether you have coverage. This is kind of a notion of, we assume in most places that electric power is available. I mean, it may not be always, and we may sometimes have to do balloons and maybe equivalent of that, generators and things like that. But we essentially assume that many things are only deployable as a consumer or as a large-scale industrial good because we have electric power of some sort, what might be a generator in some cases. And so I would imagine many of these applications now are going to be driven by essentially automating and instrumenting things in all kinds of places, and that has to be in an environment where universal connectivity, possibly by different carriers again, because not everybody is going to have 100% coverage. And they're going to be niche carriers that essentially just serve, maybe through other means, not traditional cellular, satellite, LEO type of stuff, balloons and drones and what have you, serve very remote areas. And they all need to be operating seamlessly, because many of the people who use networks, and that's probably kind of my other kind of meta prediction, is increasingly we had the first stage was applications. First stage of networking was only network carriers were smart enough to build network applications, primarily voice and some video and so on. The next one was the over-the-top applications. So third parties, increasingly students, normal people, so to say, could write network applications because we all learned it in college, if we study at a university such as yours. And thirdly is non-networking people that do plumbing and do heating and air conditioning, that drive taxis or operate taxis, that do all kinds of other things, that are medical doctors, all of us that have no interest whatsoever, and where even the quote technology companies are not really networking technology companies, they want to deploy those. And so many of these applications will be vertically integrated up, vertical applications that are not necessarily bandwidth intensive, but are ubiquitous in that. And they're going to be not one. We've never had, I have in another talk, I talk about kind of a history of a killer application. That word has fortunately disappeared. People have realized that there isn't a killer application. There's likely going to be really important stuff to me and maybe to you, but to nobody else, and that's okay, because we can all, the cost of adding one more is so small.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Schulzrinne.
Thank you.
I request Dean Economics and R&D of IIIT-B to facilitate Professor Schulzrinne with momentum. Thanks to all of you who have come all the way from CDOT, Cisco, Intel, Samsung, Tejas Networks, and incubating companies to come over here to listen to the talk. So we'll be having this lecture series throughout the year, and we'll inform you as and when we schedule it. So we have coffee and tea outside for only the guests, not for you. So we have it outside. Please join us for coffee and tea. Thank you very much. We hope to see you again.